From our nation's capital in Washington, D.C., the Department of the Army proudly presents the United States Army Field Band. As the premier touring representative of the United States Army, the musical ambassadors of the Army log thousands of miles each year, bringing the Army's message to the grassroots of our nation. The concert band, the soldiers' chorus, the jazz ambassadors, and the volunteers all contribute their unique musical talents to the field band's outreach to America. Our ongoing series of educational media materials provides information that can benefit musicians at any level of development.
The trumpet section of the United States Army Field Band, Washington, D.C., the musical ambassadors of the Army, and this is A Trumpeter's Resource.
In this DVD, you'll find information and advice on many aspects of trumpet playing and musicianship, from breathing, embouchure, and basic fundamentals, to equipment, practice techniques, and the audition process.
Whether you're a beginner looking for a little extra help, a more advanced player wanting a different perspective, or a band director interested in an educational resource, we think you'll find something of value here.
Thanks for your time and enjoy.
Playing the trumpet can be a lot of fun. On the other hand, it can be difficult and frustrating at times. Our goal in this presentation is to instill easy-to-grasp, logical, and natural approaches to help you or your students gain success quickly and with a positive attitude.
Just now, was he thinking about breathing? No, of course not. Breathing is natural and automatic. While playing, it's essential to keep your air usage comfortable and relaxed. Natural and easy breathing is the key to success.
When playing the trumpet, the air should always be moving, either in or out, a two-part process. A common mistake among many players is the addition of this third step, making the process inhalation, hold, exhalation. By holding the breath even for a second, you create tension that results in a choked or thin tone.
You can quickly gain the basic concept of an open, relaxed breath by using the words how to. The first step to an open breath is to have good posture with your torso upright and tall. Say the word how silently, which will open the throat and allow a more silent, deep breath that extends down to the abdomen. Your abdomen should move out without the shoulders rising.
For the exhalation, say the word to. Think of blowing out candles on a birthday cake. The air should rush out in a steady flow while maintaining that same open throat feeling as with your inhalation. Notice how the inhalation flows directly into the exhalation. There is no middle step of holding the air back. Try to make this type of breathing a part of your everyday practice.
Most problems on the trumpet can be traced back to improper air usage. A great breathing exercise is to put a piece of paper on a music stand and angle it slightly away from you. Take one step back. With a full breath, focus your air and try to blow the paper off the stand. Once you can do that easily, take another small step back and try it again. You will need to move a good volume of air, as well as focus the stream to blow the paper off at greater distances.
Another great way to practice moving lots of air is to use a plastic tube. A tube with a diameter of between 3/4 and 1 1/2 inches is best. Or you can simply roll up a piece of paper if you don't have a plastic tube available. Exercises you can try with the tube or the paper might go something like this. Place the tube between your teeth, then take 5 relaxed inhales and exhales without any break. Now, take an additional 5 inhales and exhales without that tube, but add the 2 syllable to the exhalations. Now, immediately play a relaxed note on the trumpet. The object is to transfer the feeling of the tube breathing to the trumpet. It's very, very important to do this exercise from tube to trumpet without any break, so your body can immediately replicate the sensation before your mind can incorporate bad habits and tension.
Some problems you should be aware of include breathing from the chest instead of the abdomen, the shoulders rising towards the ears due to tension, and the sound of a hiss, which means your throat has become closed or become more tight.
Now that our breathing is efficient and relaxed, it's time to put the mouthpiece on the embouchure. The embouchure is the placement of the lips, facial muscles, and jaw while playing the trumpet. A good embouchure, when combined with proper air usage, allows a player to develop and maintain good tone quality, range, flexibility, and endurance.
Although embouchures will vary slightly from player to player, a good embouchure generally exhibits the same fundamental characteristics. The lips should be slightly rolled in, the corners firm, the muscles of the chin pull down to form a U. Don't push your lips together at the aperture. Instead, feel as though you are holding them apart. You can simulate the feeling by placing a small straw between your teeth, as described in the segment, How to Start a Beginner.
Now, let's place the mouthpiece on the embouchure. You can use a mirror to check your mouthpiece placement. The placement should be as symmetrical as possible. I mean, centered left to right and top to bottom. This is the suggested placement, but different players will vary slightly based on lip shape and dental formation. As a general rule, drastic non-symmetrical placements should be avoided. The embouchure and mouthpiece should be wet for most players, just enough moisture so it doesn't stick. Minimize your mouthpiece pressure, just make a good seal. With the lips on an even plane with the teeth, you should be able to see 4 quadrants of red. No lip is overlapping one another, the teeth are slightly apart, and the aperture is in line with the space between the teeth. This will result in the trumpet having a somewhat downward angle while you play.
Finally, we're ready to make a sound on the mouthpiece. Too often, players try to buzz on their mouthpiece rather than have it happen naturally. To find the correct balance between aperture focus and volume of air, try this exercise. After breathing in, form your embouchure just as you begin to blow. Rather than trying to buzz, start with a wide aperture so only air is heard. Gradually focus the airstream while continuing to blow fully. A buzz will happen naturally as a result of the balance between airflow and focus. Once buzzing occurs, it is important to learn to focus that vibration into the most efficient and concentrated sound possible. Making the aperture too small will reduce the air volume, dampen the lip vibration, and produce an overly pinched sound. A perfect aperture size with good balance of lip tension and air pressure produces an ideal sound.
An ideal sound can only be produced with that full open breath we practiced earlier.
And again, the embouchure is unique to each individual. Try to incorporate some of the basic concepts we've given you as guidelines. What matters is the sound, not the look.
It's important to get off to the right start when learning to play the trumpet, so we're going to demonstrate a surefire method that ensures a proper, natural embouchure for all students. It's important to spend plenty of time with this starter method so that the creation of the buzz is truly a result of this blowing exercise. Begin by having the students place a small straw in between their front teeth. Be sure that the straw is parallel to the ground. Begin blowing air through the straw for four counts. You can use this time to teach basic counting concepts. Blow a whole note, then half notes, then quarter notes. Stay focused on the straw being straight out and just blowing air for a couple of days. Now comes the fun part. Gently slide the mouthpiece over the straw and continue the same simple blowing exercises. Take plenty of time to get comfortable again with the added mouthpiece. Remember to simply breathe and blow through the straw. After the students are comfortable with blowing whole notes and half notes, it's time to make some sound. Gently remove the straw while they are blowing a whole note. The removal of the plastic from between their lips will allow the lips to vibrate naturally. The space left by the straw creates a perfect aperture and good jaw alignment. If no buzz occurs, ensure that the student is continuing to blow with a very full airstream. At this point, they should be making a good buzz on the mouthpiece. Continue only on the mouthpiece for another class, again using this time to teach basic counting concepts. Now we're ready to add the horn. Sit in a straight-backed chair with no arms, holding the horn in your left hand. Gently place the mouthpiece in the receiver with a slight turn to the right. Never bang it in. Your left hand should grasp around the valves, and your right hand should form a C with your fingertips over the valves. Your arms should be out from your sides and holding the trumpet in a relaxed fashion. With the fundamentals in place, you should be ready to have fun learning to play the trumpet.
Articulating clearly is one of the basic requirements for a trumpet player. Remember that good articulation serves the sound. Always listen for a good sound following your articulation.
Good tonguing comes from the combination of solid airflow, the tongue, and the use of firm fingers. You might find it interesting to note that the first thing I mentioned was a solid airflow. When you forget to keep the airflow strong throughout your articulation, the sound begins to suffer. Here's an example of poor tonguing followed by good tonguing.
The tongue's role is to act as a valve. Its only job is to create an interruption in the airstream, which we hear is the articulation. Aim for a combination of quick tongue movement and steady airflow to avoid sluggish articulation.
Too many times, we trumpet players forget the importance of pressing the valves down firmly as we play. No matter how well your air and tongue are working, if you add lazy fingers, the resulting sound will be less than desirable. Listen as a portion of this scale is performed first using lazy and then firm fingers. Thank you.
Since all notes are not meant to be produced in the same manner, try starting notes with a variety of syllables. That will allow you to present your music in many different ways. Most trumpet players find two as a good reference point to begin with. As you get better at tonguing, experiment with using a variety of syllables. To, ta, do, da, and do are all used by trumpet players in different musical situations.
You should also experiment with using different degrees of intensity. Some notes in music are meant to be presented with incredible authority, while others should sound as if they came out of nowhere. Practice a wide range so you'll be ready for any situation.
The first exercises we suggest you play involve only the mouthpiece. Start by tonguing a few isolated pitches in your middle range. To make sure you're playing in tune, try this at a piano or with another trumpet player. Remember to listen to the sound after the articulation. Once you're comfortable with isolated pitches, try re-articulating on the same pitch. For your tonguing to sound easy and smooth, you must project your airflow through each articulation. Don't back away as you tongue each note.
We find scales to be a great tool for articulation practice. Play any major or minor scale in whatever rhythmic pattern you want. Listen for crisp, clean articulations followed by a full sound. Herbert L. Clark's Technical Studies for the Cornet is a book we highly recommend. The exercises in it can be used to work on many areas of your playing. Choose any of the first three studies, slurring them the first time and articulating the second. Your airflow should be the same, whether you're slurring or tonguing.
Arbenz is another method book every trumpet player should own. In regards to tonguing, the exercises on pages 17 through 22 and 28 through 36 are extremely helpful. A good practice method for these is to alternate between slurring and tonguing each phrase, which will remind you to keep the air full as you articulate. On page 125 of the Arben book, you can find interval studies. These add larger leaps into your articulation practice. Concentrate on blowing through the center of your trumpet and not trying to physically position each note. Listen for the same quality of sound and articulation on every note as you play through the exercise.
When you have a passage that's too fast to single tongue, multiple tonguing is your only option. There are two types of multiple tonguing, double and triple. We recommend learning triple tonguing first because it uses a fluid tongue motion. However, all the concepts we discuss also apply to double tonguing.
Being able to multiple tongue comes from the combination of two syllables, tu and ku. Since we already use tu in single tonguing, ku is the one that will require some work and patience. Your goal is to make the ku sound the same as the tu. The basic pattern for double tonguing is 2-ku, and for triple, it's 2-2-ku.
Always remember that good airflow is a necessity for quality multiple tonguing. Combine that with the use of firm fingers, and you'll be on your way to success. Finally, always start slowly. If you add speed too soon, you'll risk sacrificing your technique and sound.
The Arben book is a great source for multiple tonguing exercises. Use the first exercise in the triple tonguing section to concentrate on your ku syllable. The first note of each measure, use tu, but for every note after, use ku. The goal is for both syllables to sound the same.
Once you have gained some success with that, it is time to slowly perform the pattern of 2-2-ku. As that becomes easier and better coordinated, begin the process of increasing the tempo. Use a metronome and write down the tempo where you can comfortably play the given exercise. After a week or two, increase the speed and learn it at that new tempo. This is a great way to keep track of your progress.
Here are some final thoughts about tonguing. Always strive to keep the airflow very strong and rich. You should press your valves down firmly to avoid a muddy sound. When practicing your multiple tonguing, start very slowly and gradually speed up as you get better. Remember to always practice your single and multiple tonguing in a variety of articulations, tempos, and registers. You want to be prepared for as many different situations as you can be. And finally, keep in mind that all this is meant to serve your sound and the music. Therefore, make your tonguing and articulation practice as musical as possible.
Effortless control and the freedom to express your musical interpretation to the fullest will make your performance both exciting and artistic. In this segment, we'll be discussing the importance of flexibilities in our trumpet performance and ways in which we can develop them.
Our aim is to enhance our performance with a fluid command of the instrument that allows us to play anything we want. Flexibilities are an important part of the trumpeter's daily routine. The ability to move around the trumpet easily in many registers while maintaining a beautiful sound is essential for good musical performance.
As with the other aspects of trumpet practice, there are many ways of practicing flexibilities, all of which strive to reach the same basic goals. The major goals of flexibilities are a relaxed and beautiful full sound that doesn't change. Balance, air support, and good tongue level control are essential. Consistent airflow, going from note center to note center, and a solid center on all the notes as you move throughout the range.
Some popular methods of flexibility practice include the Schlossberg, Irons, Colin, Vizzuti, Arban, and St. Jacome, to name a few of the most readily available.
We're going to explain the basics of flexibilities so that whichever method you choose, you can apply it to your practice. Remember to use a metronome for your flexibility practice so the different systems involved can learn to coordinate in time, an essential ingredient in good flexibility practice and performance. Start with the metronome at a relatively slow tempo and play at a very comfortable dynamic, somewhere around mezzo piano to mezzo forte. We're going to start in the middle register and expand in both directions until we are eventually playing through several octaves with a smooth and easy sound. I'm going to start with an easy flexibility practice.
Notice how he took a full breath and played with a relaxed, easy sound throughout the exercise. Now, you would continue throughout the exercises in this manner, resting as much as you play. Focus on good time, good sound, and good intonation.
Listen to your sound. A good balanced sound is what we're striving for here. Never allow the exercises to sound forced or abrupt. A smooth airflow is essential. If you're having trouble with a particular exercise, slow it down. Many times, slow repetition is needed to master an exercise or find the correct balance for a good sound. Be patient.
As you advance with your flexibility practice, you may add another partial in either direction and expand your flexibility range and speed. For example, the first week you may spend a lot of time slurring from middle G up to C, back to G, down to low C, and back to G again. Take your time. Get these slurs to sound beautiful. Like anything on the trumpet, learning can be a very slow process, and teaching the many musical systems to function together in coordination takes time and practice.
The next thing we're going to discuss with regard to flexibility practice is expanding your flexibility range. Remember, rest as much as you play and don't ever force something out. If it isn't coming easy after two or three tries, stop. Then try again the next day.
Expansion of flexibilities is often done gradually in opposite directions. As we play further through the irons method, we notice that as another higher partial is added, an equal and lower partial will be added soon after.
It is so important to realize that as we go on in our flexibility practice, you really feel and understand where you are on the trumpet. The trumpet is not a visual instrument like the piano. Its tremendous range exists very much in the mind of the player. This is why it's so important for you to visualize where you are and what you're doing at all times, and really start internalizing the music.
As you begin to internalize these concepts, you will want to try different methods of flexibility practice to find the one which suits you the best. There are many out there, so check with your teacher to find out about the many books available on this subject.
Remember the important points of flexibility practice: sound, balance, flow, and center. Don't forget to rest as often as you play. Flexibility practice is fatiguing and should be done with adequate rest intervals. We're trying to build up our systems, not break them down or teach them bad habits.
A few closing thoughts about practicing flexibilities. Practice them often and practice them correctly. Be patient and listen to your sound.
That's right. Sound is priority number one. Listen to yourself. Your musical voice is worth all the attention you can give it, and with patient, slow practice, you too will be on the road to becoming a more flexible and efficient trumpet player. We all want to build on our range and endurance. We're going to talk about ways to develop a solid upper register and improve your overall endurance.
For many performers, playing in the upper register with a relaxed and full sound can be a difficult task.
Those who have acquired this skill will agree that upper register playing is something that must be practiced regularly with a very relaxed and patient approach.
Often, high register playing goes hand in hand with having very good endurance. First, let's go over a few rules for upper register and endurance practice.
An important thing to remember is to rest as much as you play. If you do an exercise that is 30 seconds in length, rest that long.
During this rest period, be sure to flutter your chops so that you help replenish the blood supply to all your facial muscles. Fluttering in this fashion will help not only the lips, but the many facial muscles involved in playing the trumpet.
Focus on your breath. Relaxed inhales with a good open flow to the exhale, not pushing or holding back either.
Finally, focus on your sound at all times. Strive for a relaxed, full sound that's open and free, never pinched or constricted sounding.
Remember, range and endurance practice should be done a little at a time and never in a rushed fashion, so be patient.
The first thing we're going to discuss is breath building. The air supply is of paramount importance when trying to increase range or endurance. Let's start out by taking a few relaxed inhales and exhales with an open throat, making the sound O. Oh.
Make sure you're filling up your lungs from the bottom up and getting an unrestricted inhale, and follow that with the lungs emptying also from the bottom up.
If it helps, get a 1.5-inch piece of PVC or clear tubing and use this to help keep that open feeling on the inhale and exhale. Don't force the breaths.
Let's start on G in the staff and play a long tone. Relaxed and full, hold it until you're out of breath. Good. Now let's rest as long as we just played. Or if you're practicing with a friend, trade off playing the exercises with them. Before we go on, make sure that your exhale through the trumpet is relaxed, just like when you were breathing with an open throat or on the PVC pipe. Focus on an open sound.
Now that we have the sensation of an unrestricted long tone, we are going to continue with these in opposite directions. First down a half step to F sharp, and then up to G sharp, down to F, up to A, etc. Take rest time in between each one and flutter your chops in the rest periods. Again, if practicing with a friend, trade off playing and resting. Continue this way until you reach low F sharp and G above the staff.
After this exercise becomes easy to play without force end with a big open sound, you may start on middle C and expand from there to low F sharp and high F sharp. Remember the fundamentals: open sound, good breath, frequent rest, and lots of fluttering.
Another variation is to add some tonguing on the sustained notes. Keep your air moving and lightly articulate two or three times on each note. This keeps your tongue flexible and engaged, not stiff or rigid.
This exercise will develop excellent breath support using an open sound. It also develops the facial muscles needed for support around the lips and embouchure. Remember, your lips should never be stretched too tight or be too tense. Poor sound quality will result. They should be free to vibrate, and your larger facial muscles should be engaged, taking on most of the muscular support role. The result should be a relaxed and solid tone.
The Clark technical studies are great range and endurance building exercises. Chromatic scales are a wonderful way to gradually expand your range and build your endurance without straining the lips or changing the tone. Remember to always make a beautiful sound.
To illustrate the tonal concept we're trying to apply here, take your mouthpiece and buzz a siren up and down as smooth and as slow as possible with a fat and rich sound. When we play chromatics, we should also produce a thick, fat sound, and remember that our sound doesn't change as we ascend or descend. Watch now as he plays a chromatic scale from C to C and pay close attention to the sound. It doesn't change.
Now, as we start our practice of the Clark studies, think of the siren as you smoothly move through the instrument's range. Let's do exercise number one at a medium-soft dynamic, then rest and go on to the next example. If you have progressed to the point where you hear your sound quality change as you ascend and descend, then you need to back up one half step and keep practicing this one for a few days. After several days of easily playing this exercise, reattempt the next chromatic. If it comes easier and doesn't change in sound quality, then you may continue ascending by half steps in this manner.
Patience is key in this type of practice. It will pay off in the long run with an easier sound in the high register and better endurance. A teacher once told me that in order to build your range, you must expose your chops to the higher notes gradually, but you must expose them or they'll never adjust and figure these tones out. Don't be afraid to push yourself, but always work towards a good sound.
The practicing of pedal tones is also beneficial to the development of range and endurance. Pedal tones, or notes below low F sharp, are tones that must be produced by a big, warm, and balanced airstream. These notes will not sound when forced and must be well supported with a full, moving airstream. The pedal range should be fingered just like the octave above it, and your embouchure should not change greatly to produce the tones. Good corner support, an open oral cavity, and a full air column are all necessary to produce these notes properly.
A very simple pedal tone exercise that is excellent for loosening up and playing with an open sound is descending octave arpeggios played slowly, with crescendos through the arpeggio. For example, start on F and descend to C, A, and low F. Continue this as far down as you can go, keeping a good sound and resting in between examples. C to pedal C is a good goal to set, but if you can continue beyond that, keep going. If you hear the sound thinning out or changing radically, try three times for that note and then put it down and come back to it the next day.
I like to use pedal tones to really grip the notes and get my air moving with a full, relaxed air column. I use it to warm up, warm down, or loosen up any time. They are an excellent tool for really setting a good embouchure and letting your lips vibrate easily. Playing in the upper register, an extreme upper register, requires good corner support and a full air column, just like pedal tones.
As you practice things like Clark studies and high flexibilities, interject some pedal tones into your practice just to keep your lips loose. You'll know right away if you're too tight. The pedal simply won't sound.
As a variation, and to protect yourself from getting stiff, try alternating loud and soft exercises. The concepts are the same, so you should not change very much to produce these tones softly. Pitch bends are another good tool to use to keep flexible. If you are too tight, you will crack the note, so make sure to stay flexible.
As you work on developing your high register, don't neglect the importance of good flexibility. A solid high register is one that is not too tight or brittle sounding, so make sure you include some extended range flexibility work in your practice regimen.
Earl Iron's method numbers 11 through 17 are good exercises for the extension of range and flexibility. Do them slowly at first and steadily increase your speed until you're moving easily and nimbly throughout the full range of the instrument.
High register playing is something that takes many hours of practice to acquire and only a few days of neglect to lose.
Playing music and etudes that challenge you in the upper register is just as important as doing the calisthenic exercises. Having great musical skill is useless if you never put it into practice playing music.
Walter Smith's top tones are a good example of etudes that present many challenges to a player's endurance and upper register facility.
Most of all, be sure to stick to your practice schedule, and you'll become a more well-rounded and solid trumpet player.
To those of you seeking a career in trumpet playing, congratulations. Someday, all of this will be yours. The stage represents all the tools the field band trumpet section uses on a daily basis. The more experienced you become, the more equipment you'll find yourself using. What you're expected to own is determined by what kind of groups you play with.
Orchestral players play a lot of C trumpet and may need a B flat, D E flat, or piccolo trumpet as well.
Jazz, commercial, or big band players typically need a B flat trumpet, flugelhorn, and a few extra mutes.
If you're into the music of Bach and Handel, you'll eventually want a piccolo trumpet and maybe even an authentic Baroque trumpet.
Some classical players use many varieties of the same mute to give themselves more tone colors to choose from.
The bottom line is, the more versatile you are, the more work you get, the more stuff you'll need.
Don't worry, we're not telling you to buy a bunch of stuff right now. You should buy something only if you're going to need it. For example, if your band is playing a piece that calls for cup mute and you don't have one, you should pick one up. If you're a high school senior who plans on playing in university jazz ensembles, you'll want a harmon mute and maybe a flugelhorn. A college freshman looking for a career in an orchestra will need a sea trumpet soon. But there's no reason for a high school freshman to have all that stuff. Pick up your equipment as you go.
First, let's talk about instruments and mouthpieces. Choosing an instrument or mouthpiece is like picking at shoes, clothes, or new car. It's all about personal preference. Everything out there works for somebody, and nothing works for everybody. As your playing matures, you'll figure out what works for you and develop your own preferences. Although it's important to have role models, never choose your equipment because someone else plays on it. Try not to be that guy who asks Mater Ferguson what size mouthpiece he plays on. It would be like asking an NBA star for his shoe size.
For students who are in their first few years of playing, here's a little mouthpiece advice. Don't go too shallow too soon. Many jazz and commercial lead players use shallow mouthpieces to brighten their sound and strengthen their upper register, but those mouthpieces should not be relied upon as a crutch for range. Those same lead players will tell you that breathing is everything, and when used by young players, shallow mouthpieces can discourage airflow. Learn to breathe first. A box 7C equivalent is a good size for most beginners. You might go to a 5C after 2 or 3 years, and maybe a 3C by junior or senior year. After that, go your own way.
For trumpets, I only recommend you play the instrument before buying it. If you can't see it, hold it, and play it for yourself, you can't know whether you'll like it. If you're in a store with several different trumpets, try them all. Narrow down what you like, starting with brand name, then model, and finally, individual instruments. No two instruments are exactly alike.
Even if you already know you want a box Stradivarius, you might as well try all the Strads in the store. You'll probably like one more than the others. In fact, bring a friend along to listen. A second opinion is always good to have. If you're buying a horn you can't try first, over the internet for example, buy it only if you have the option of returning it. You don't want to drop $1,000 and get stuck with a horn you don't like. Believe me, you wouldn't be the first.
So you go to a trumpet conference, you're looking through the exhibits, and there are trumpets everywhere. How do you tell the good ones from the bad? Watch now as we demonstrate what not to do. You'll see those players in the exhibit halls, but don't let it be you. First, look over the horn. No dents, the valves feel good, the mouthpiece fits snugly with no wobble, and when you play the horn, start with simple stuff like long tones. What's the sound of the instrument like? That's the most important thing. After an easy flow study or two, play some scales that take you into the upper and lower registers. See if the instrument sounds full throughout its whole range. Play some simple melodies in a couple of different keys and see which notes are out of tune. Play some fingering exercises to see how the valves work. Finally, try out a solo or etude you've been playing on your own instrument and see how the new instrument compares to yours. Watch now as he will demonstrate how to effectively get to know a trumpet.
As your trumpet playing progresses, you'll naturally play more and more difficult music, which may require different kinds of mutes. The ones we'll go into here are the most common. Remember, buy them as needed.
The first mute you're likely to use is the straight mute. Most straight mutes give the trumpet a more piercing, biting quality. They're most often used on articulated sections and don't usually carry lyrical melodies. Here's an example. The next most common mute is the cup mute. The cup mute softens the trumpet sound quite a bit, both in tone color and volume. It's mostly used for soft, pretty melodies. Here's an example.
Mm-hmm.
Next in line is the Harmon mute. The Harmon is both the most expensive and the weirdest looking, with a hole in the end and a stem that comes out of it. It's usually played with the stem removed, but not always. Here it is with the stem. And here's the more classic Harmon sound without the stem. The last one I'll demonstrate is the plunger. This is exactly what it looks like, just a toilet plunger. Some of the stuff I've talked about today can be expensive, I know. But there's no excuse not to have one of these. Like the Harmon mute, it's used mostly in jazz or big band playing, and players have used it in fun and creative ways. With practice, you can make a lot of cool sounds with it. Here's an excerpt from a famous big band piece that calls for plunger.
One important note about mutes. They change not only the tone, but also the pitch of the instrument. Some mutes will push the pitch a little sharp. Some will push it way, way sharp, while others will actually push it a little flat. There's no law that says which mutes do exactly what. It depends on the horn, the type of mute, the brand of mute, etc. Whichever mutes you own and use, practice with them and get to know their tendencies.
There are other mutes you'll see from time to time, but those four are the most common. One last mute you might think about is a practice mute. They make mutes designed for silence, which can be extremely useful if you ever practice at night or if you live with unappreciative listeners.
As a musician, professional or not, there's one last thing you'll be expected to have, and it's one of the most important, recordings. Through listening to great recordings and attending great concerts when possible, you'll develop your own concept of what you want to sound like. This is just as important as practicing. Incorporating the style of your favorite players into your own playing is an important step in a player's development.
That about wraps it up for equipment. If you remember anything we've said, remember this. A musician's career is not a quest for the perfect equipment setup. Your time will be better spent practicing and listening to your role models.
Your warm-up should serve two basic needs. It prepares you both physically and mentally for the rest of your playing day. From the physical standpoint, you're getting all the muscles that are needed for playing ready for the day's work. Mentally, it's your chance to focus your attention upon the basic concepts that are needed to play the trumpet well, such as sound, breathing, and creating a musical line.
Remember, the warm-up is more about applying the fundamentals of trumpet playing than completing every warm-up exercise. You may find that the amount of time you need will vary from day to day. Just make sure that no matter how much time you use, your warm-up should address each of the areas we're about to go over.
A good breath is the most basic concept of all, and therefore the perfect place to begin. Almost all problems in trumpet playing, both technical and musical, can be traced back to poor airflow. The four principles of a good breath are: breathe full and with energy, breathe in time and in character with the music, keep the air in constant motion, and try to waste the air through a focused, rich airstream.
For specific breathing exercises, refer to the chapter on breathing. Trumpet players have a tendency to let the fact that metal's on our face or that music is in front of us change our airflow. Therefore, perform breathing exercises throughout your playing day, especially at the beginning, to apply the four principles of a good breath. The better you breathe, the better you'll play. Don't forget to breathe.
After breathing, spend some time playing on the mouthpiece. Listen for a sound that is smooth and consistent throughout all registers. Start by playing in your middle range and then expanding higher and lower as you warm up.
Two of my favorite things to play on the mouthpiece are smears and simple tunes. Smears are good for making sure you're connecting notes with smooth airflow instead of trying to slot each individual pitch. Simple tunes, such as Amazing Grace, America, or Christmas songs, are great because they require you to approach mouthpiece playing in a musical way.
A flow study refers to a simple musical line that develops a full, relaxed sound by using good airflow. When playing flow studies, listen to the quality of your sound and ask yourself these questions. Is the sound rich and brilliant? Am I moving smoothly and consistently from one note to the next? And is my airflow being projected through the trumpet with energy at all times? Vincent Chickowitz's set of flow studies, commonly referred to as VC studies, are some of the most popular to use. Move air through the entire line and not just from note to note.
The flow studies of James Stamp are especially useful for extending your range into the pedal tones. Do your best to allow whatever embouchure movement that happens to be as natural as possible. Your goal is a smooth and even sound as you move in and out of the pedal register.
The next step in the warm-up is to add articulation. As you tongue, blow through the articulation so that the tongue's movement doesn't affect the energy in the airflow. The tongue's only job is to create a slight interruption in the airflow, which we hear as the articulation.
Playing your scales, both major and minor, is a simple way to check your articulation. Make each scale sound like a musical line and not just a pattern of notes. The second set of exercises from Herbert L. Clark's Technical Studies for the Cornet are highly recommended for articulation practice. As you play these exercises, alternate between slurring and tonguing to check that your air is moving with the same energy either way. Always strive for a clean front to each articulated note.
Remember that good articulation involves more than just one generic way to present a sound. Warm up using a variety of articulation styles so that you'll have an assortment ready for when the time comes that you need them. Also try articulating at different tempos and dynamics.
Slurs are the final area we suggest you involve in your warm-up. A slur is nothing more than two notes connected by air. Move air through the note change to keep the sound smooth, and slur at different tempos and dynamics.
Slurring exercises are very easy to make up on the spot. Start in the low register and work your way up.
Thank you.
Keep your sound full and resonant as you slur from one note to the next. Pay special attention to the last half of each note because that's an easy place for your sound to lose resonance. Listen and compare the difference between a bad and good example. Warm-up, use basic exercises that move throughout your range but do not extend beyond your limits. Advanced slurs are great for building flexibility and range, but are best done after you have sufficiently warmed up. Leave those exercises to later in the day.
Some final thoughts about warming up. Play only as high as is comfortable for you and sounds good. When you reach the point where the sound is beginning to suffer, stop. Leave advanced slurs for after your warm-up. While the majority of your warm-up should be done at a comfortable dynamic, vary it some. This is especially helpful when warming up after a tough previous day. And finally, once you finish with your warm-up, take a short break before moving on. Use it as a chance to grab a drink of water and plan out the rest of your playing day. At the end of your playing day or a particularly difficult session, play a few exercises that will help your muscles and mind relax. This is also a great opportunity to double check that you're still breathing and playing in a very relaxed, efficient way. Never leave a playing session with a lot of tension. It's very likely that your next will be affected.
The majority of your warm down should be done at a mid to soft dynamic range because you want your embouchure to regain some of the focus it may have lost due to heavy playing. Also, remember that your warm down is not meant to be another full playing session. Therefore, keep it to 5 minutes or less.
Start your warm down by softly playing some chromatic motion or scales that begin in the staff and move down into the lower register. Concentrate on creating a sighing motion with your air as it is released through the trumpet. The goal is for it to sound as effortless as possible.
Lip bends are a great warm-down device. Choose any note in the middle register and then move to the half step below it. After returning to the original note, try bending the pitch to the half step without using the valve. To do this, you must project a lot of air. Once a half step becomes easy, repeat the process using a whole step. This exercise is especially useful in the middle register.
Play this next exercise with a metronome. Set it to quarter note equals 60, and then as soft as you can, allow the air to start the note without involving the tongue. Like lip bends, choose a few notes in the mid to low register to use. After holding the tone for 2 beats, relax the embouchure to where only air is passing through the trumpet. It's very important that the air never stops flowing during this exercise. After 2 beats of air, focus the aperture again to make the tone come back. Repeat this several times. Your goal should be to accomplish this with relative ease and smoothness.
Pedal tones are great because they require both your air and embouchure to be working efficiently. You can use the stamp flow studies from the warm-up section or create your own exercises that descend into the pedal register. Just make sure to have a big, full sound on the pedals. Concentrate on the movement of air and creating your best sound.
Because the warm down shouldn't take too long, don't feel that it's necessary to have to play each of these different exercises each time. Pick and choose what works best for you and would help to relax you the most. Finally, remember that your dynamic range should be on the softer side. The goal should be to loosen and relax, not cause more tension. The daily maintenance routine is your chance to make sure that all of the basic concepts required to play the trumpet well are being accomplished. These concepts include sound, breathing, articulation, flexibility, agility, range, and endurance. Completing your daily routine every day is not a substitute for practicing, nor is it meant to take the place of a good warm-up and warm-down. The daily routine's main priority is to learn how to be a more efficient trumpet player. Practicing and listening to great music and musicians is the way to expand your musicianship and broaden your abilities. With this in mind, make sure that you are creating a balance between your daily routine, daily practicing, and daily listening.
So, what exercises should you include in your daily routine? Well, a healthy diet of flow studies, slurs, tonguing, range, and endurance exercises are great places to start. Since the majority of these topics are covered in their own sections on this DVD, this chapter is more about creating an outline for you to follow. If you would like a more in-depth look in any of these individual areas, please select that chapter on the DVD.
Have several different types of exercises that will achieve the same goal, to keep your routine interesting and full of variety. Also, continue to raise your expectation level as you find it easier to play your routine. This can be done by increasing the tempo, expanding the range, and more narrowly focusing your listening.
Since your playing demands can change from day to day, having a variety of routines can be very helpful. We spend a third of the year traveling across the country performing concerts, and it can be difficult to practice. We have all learned to create routines that fit our ever-changing needs.
That brings up a great point. Perhaps one of the most fundamental jobs of the daily routine is to bring balance to your trumpet playing. If you have a week of rehearsals and concerts that are very demanding, your routine should concentrate on lighter material. The opposite is true as well. If your playing week is relatively easy, that's the time to push yourself.
Begin your routine with basic flow studies, such as the VCs or the stamp exercises we discussed in the warm-up and warm-down. After you feel and sound warmed up, play some extended flow studies. Take etudes that you like to play and turn them into flow studies by slurring everything. These studies should either be longer or have extended range. The same concepts apply to these as the simpler studies. Let the air be full and rich as you move through the phrases and concentrate on creating the greatest sound you can on the trumpet.
When slurring, use the routine to either focus on basic or simple slurs, or to work on more advanced ones. Start with some basic slurs to make sure everything sounds good before moving on. If you're having trouble, then stick to the basics. If you're sounding good and doing well, then it's time to push yourself.
Simple slurs are easy to create on the spot. You can create more advanced ones by increasing the speed and range, or by changing the dynamics. If you would like to use a book, we suggest Arben's Complete Method for the Trumpet, Iron's 27 groups of exercises, or Schlossberg's daily drills and technical studies for the trumpet.
Practice your slurs using extremes. Take any slurring exercise and begin by playing it loud and very slow. Listen for a full sound as you connect the notes. Don't back away. Immediately following, do the same exercise soft and very fast. This will ensure that you are relying on efficiency of playing and not just muscle and force to play the slurs. Otherwise, the second slur will not happen or be very difficult to play.
The term articulation refers to the musical means by which we initiate the sounds we make. This is important because every note is not necessarily meant to be presented in the same way. Some require finesse, while others are meant to shock you through power. We accomplish good articulation through the use of good tonguing. The ability to tongue well comes from the combination of airflow, the tongue, and using firm fingers.
Use scales, method books, and etudes to practice your single tonguing, and experiment using different degrees of intensity as you practice. Some days work on your legato soft entrances, and other days spend time on very firm accents. Your goal should be to have such an assortment of articulations readily available that you are always prepared for any musical situation.
It's also necessary to spend some time on your multiple tonguing. As with single tonguing, project your air through the tonguing as you use firm fingers. Always begin slow and then get faster as you progress. Never sacrifice a good sound for speed.
After tonguing, we suggest that you work on your range. Remember that the goal is for the upper register to sound no different than the lower registers. This can be accomplished by playing exercises both loud and soft throughout your usable range. Always rely upon good airflow and a focused embouchure from the lowest pedal tones to the top of your range, not pressure. And above all else, know your limits. We advise alternating between days of going to the point where the sound begins to suffer and days where you take it a few steps beyond. The only way to build your range is to get up there and go for it, but don't push yourself too hard every day.
Next, choose a few technical or lyrical etudes to play. This is a very important step because it reminds you that we work on all these different mechanical facets so that we can perform music easier. Alternate between days of choosing etudes you enjoy playing and others that are less familiar. Remember that this isn't necessarily the time to practice the etudes, just have fun and play. This is where having an assortment of method and etude books comes in handy. Look at our website for a list of what we suggest you own.
Finally, make sure to end your daily routine with a warm down. You can choose any of the materials from the Warm Down chapter of this DVD.
Here are some final thoughts to consider when creating your daily routine. First, have an idea as to how much time you're going to spend. If you have a very demanding performance that night, adjust your routine accordingly. Second, know your limits. It's better to aim for slight progress every day than huge leaps. Third, take plenty of breaks. A couple of minutes here and there go a long way. And finally, remember that you are your best teacher. More than anyone else, you know what areas in your playing need attention, so don't dwell on what you already do well. Hit the areas that need help. Over the long haul, that will benefit you more.
We cannot stress enough the importance of a balanced approach to practicing trumpet. Warming up, practicing fundamentals, and listening are all crucial to our development as players. The practicing of etudes and solos are equally important.
In this section, we will discuss some techniques to assist you in learning music quickly and efficiently, and show you how to apply these techniques to the preparation of pieces for auditions and performances.
Before we examine some specific techniques, we strongly recommend you consult a private teacher. He or she will help you find material that is appropriate for your current level. Giving yourself a realistic challenge is the best way to improvement.
The number one goal of practicing etudes and solos is simply to make music. Use your imagination, have fun, and experiment. We practice fundamentals to build and sharpen our skills. Etudes and solos give us the opportunity to use these skills in creative ways. Too many trumpet players ignore this important step.
Now we're going to look at some excerpts from actual etudes. When looking at a piece for the first time, it can be overwhelming and you may not know where to begin. Breaking the etude into smaller units helps. Start by making some general observations and asking yourself some questions. What's the form? What's the key? Are there dynamic contrasts? By asking some of these questions, you can obtain a wide-angle view of the piece and come up with a strategy for learning it.
Let's look at Etude No. 6 by Brandt. It comes from his book, Orchestral Etudes. The title alone provides us with some information as to what style we will be playing. Our goal should be a full, rich sound with great direction in our phrasing.
The etude tells us to play at a waltz tempo, which means that we should be thinking in one throughout with our primary emphasis on beats 1 and 3. The first way we are going to practice the etude is by playing only the eighth notes on beats 1 and 3. To further simplify, we will play all the notes above the staff down the octave so we can clearly hear the melodic line.
This time, we will play the same pattern, only we will play the first eighth note as a half note. This will give us a sense of the flowing melodic line, which we will need to keep in mind when we go back to all the intervals in the original. As we now look at the original phrase, keep in mind the fluidity of the lyrical pattern. The airstream should retain this loose, flexible character. At this point, we will play the first phrase as written, slowly. The next two patterns we will demonstrate use the exact pitches of the original, but this time we're going to manipulate the rhythm by playing all dotted eighth sixteenths and then sixteenth dotted eighths.
By changing the phrases, we teach the body to learn passages different ways. This is particularly valuable when learning a technically difficult piece. By starting from a smooth lyrical foundation, we help ensure that the finished product retains this quality.
When practicing, integrate working on small sections interspersed with run-throughs of the entire piece. Working on individual difficulties will allow you to solve technical problems, while playing through will help you develop endurance and a sense of the musical continuity.
Let's look at a few more practice patterns using an etude from the well-known Charlier etudes. Etude No. 4 starts out in a smooth, lyrical fashion. Charlier's etudes are among the best to develop musicality and a sense of style. While this opening may not appear difficult, it should be our goal to sound as effortless and elegant as possible. Instead of ingraining a muscular approach to the high G, we can start by transposing this phrase lower, learning it in a register that is completely effortless. If you don't have experience transposing, a good learning tool would be to write out the phrase on staff paper. Just the process of writing by itself will provide you with another way of learning. Listen as I demonstrate the phrase in sequentially higher keys until I reach the original.
Many well-known teachers have advocated practicing in different keys. While this may be challenging at first, start by playing simple melodies one step higher and one step lower. It's a great tool for ear training as it teaches you to really hear each interval.
We hope some of these ideas will be helpful to you as you prepare a piece of music. The more ways you can learn something and the more you challenge yourself, the faster you will improve. Make up your own patterns and use your imagination. By investing your personality and creativity in your preparation, you will bring that enthusiasm and excitement to your performance.
With regard to sound, what we said earlier about playing in the center of the pitch applies to every note on the horn. Your best sound will come from a combination of factors: a relaxed inhale and exhale, a proper embouchure setting, playing in the center of the pitch, and most importantly, having a mental image of the sound you want to play.
Having a mental image of your goal sound is like visualizing a successful shot when playing basketball. You can have all the technique in the world, but if you don't visualize where you want the ball to go, you may as well just close your eyes and throw it.
It's the same with music. You have to have a goal sound in your head before you put the trumpet to your lips. Otherwise, you're just completing a checklist of proper trumpet playing, breathing, embouchure, fingerings, and hoping that a good sound will come out of the bell.
It's challenging to play every note at its fullest resonance, but there are exercises you can do to develop the habit. Begin by playing a comfortable note on the horn, such as a middle G.
Make sure you apply the principles of a good breath that we discussed earlier and blow freely through the horn. Hold the note and very slowly lip up and then down, listening to the quality of the sound as you do this. As you bend the pitch, explore the sound differences that occur with the change in note placement. Generally, the higher you bend a note, the brighter, thinner, and less resonant it becomes. The lower the note, the fuller and more resonant it becomes, up to a certain point. Decide where you think the note resonates at its fullest and hold it.
Once you perform this exercise in a comfortable range, expand to do this for every note on the horn within your range. It may sound tedious, but this slow practice will help you develop a consistent sound throughout the range.
Once you find your best sound on each note, try incorporating this within a moving line, such as a scale. Slowly play a one-octave C scale, beginning on low C, and strive to place each note where it resonates the best the first time. Your goal is to apply this to everything you play, no matter how fast or slow. Eventually, this will become such a habit that your everyday sound will be at its best.
Now that you've worked on the technical part of getting a good sound, let's discuss that sound image we referred to earlier. The absolute best way to come up with a goal sound, a sound you want to be distinctly yours, is to listen to other trumpet players with sounds that you admire.
If you aren't able to hear great trumpeters play live, the next best thing is a recording. There's a large number of recordings available of trumpet soloists, orchestras, bands, and even movie soundtracks, and you should make it a habit of collecting them and listening to them often.
Even now, after almost a quarter century playing the trumpet, I still listen to recordings and go to live performances to be inspired and hear great trumpet sounds. You can refer to our website to find a list of excellent trumpeters to listen to.
Once you have found a few trumpet players you admire, you can begin to integrate their sound qualities into your own. Make a list of positive qualities you want in your sound using keywords such as full, rich, warm, vibrant, and strive to produce that sound every time you play the horn. It's important to listen not only to trumpeters, but other instrumentalists and vocalists as well. Qualities of good sound are universal and can be heard in any good musician.
Auditions!
Whether you are auditioning for seating in your school's band, an all-state ensemble, entrance into a college music program, or a professional organization, there are many common experiences that we can learn from and use to make us better trumpet players.
One of the best ways to prepare for an audition is to simply practice performing. Playing for your family, friends, teachers, or at church are all ways to gain confidence. The more you do it, the easier it gets.
Why do we take auditions? For fun? It's probably not most people's idea of a perfect Saturday, but it doesn't have to be a bad experience either. One way of looking at auditions is to discuss the difference between outcome thinking versus process thinking.
When you're thinking in terms of outcomes, you focus on all that could happen as the result of an audition. If I play well, I'll get first chair. What if I don't get the scholarship? How will I pay for school? These types of thoughts focus on the results of an audition.
The problem with this type of thinking is that it focuses entirely on things that are outside of your control. You cannot control what others will do or think, and worrying about those things will only rob you of energy and take your attention away from what you actually have control over.
Process thinking means that you are focused intently on the present moment, thinking thoughts that help you visualize the sound and music you plan to make. I am playing with relaxed confidence and control. I perform my best under pressure. Thoughts like these are not concerned with anything other than what you're doing at that moment.
This is the mindset that athletes describe as being in the zone. When you give up your need to control the outcome of an event, you can devote all your attention to your action.
To help yourself stay focused on the process on the day of an audition, listen to some of your favorite trumpet recordings and visualize yourself playing with your ideal tone and phrasing. Keep some 3x5 note cards in your case with some positive statements that keep your attention focused.
One of the best things to do before audition day is to perform mock auditions. A mock audition strives to simulate as many features of the actual audition as possible. Wear the clothing that you plan to wear to the audition. The day of the audition is not the time to find out that your clothes are unnecessarily restricting your breathing. Set up a tape recorder or mini disc and record the audition materials. Play straight through and then go back and listen to it, making notes of what worked well and what didn't.
Much of the anxiety we feel at an audition is just about the unknown. Mock auditions help you get acquainted with many of those things. The more prepared you are, the less you will have to be concerned about.
Watch now as we take you through a sample audition.
The first goal is to get yourself comfortable before you play. Situate your horns, mutes, and anything else you may need in the same way every time. This will eliminate any confusion or scrambling. Decide ahead of time if you will sit or stand. Typically, you would stand when playing a solo and sit when playing ensemble material. Your main objective is to feel comfortable and at ease.
Many auditions will permit playing a few notes before beginning the audition. Take advantage of this opportunity, but keep it concise. A simple scale or arpeggio is very appropriate. Do not play anything from the actual audition music or something too technically difficult.
The point is to get a feel for the room, particularly the amount of reverb to expect. The simpler the warm-up, the more you'll be able to perceive.
Now you're ready to play your best. Take a few good breaths and think of your tempo. Visualize yourself playing with your best sound, breathe in tempo, and play.
Stay focused on each moment as it's happening. Save the analysis for afterwards.
Between excerpts or selections, maximize the opportunity to rest, clear your mind, and refocus on the next piece. Most players rush from one thing to the next without pacing themselves.
Too much time is also not advisable. Just as at the beginning, visualize the tempo, breathe, and play.
Focusing on the process, staying in the moment, and visualizing your best sound will help you play your best and make the audition process a pleasant one.
Once the audition is over, regardless of the outcome, take some notes that you will keep in an audition notebook. Recall as much as you can about the things you tried, what you thought worked, and what you would change next time. By doing this, you'll use each audition as a learning experience to find out more about yourself and how you react in different situations. If you always use an audition as a learning tool to make yourself a better trumpet player, then regardless of the outcome, you will have grown from the experience. The United States Army Field Band Trumpet Section would like to thank you for your time and interest. Education is an important part of what we do, and we always appreciate the opportunity to be of use to student musicians.
We hope you found the information valuable, and that it helps you in some small way to realize your full potential.
Best wishes in your musical pursuits.